This is BBC Two with nighttime education programmes. Welcome to the Learning Zone. Numeracy skills to begin tonight's Learning Zone with FETV Collectibles, followed by Languages at 4, the beginner series, The French Experience. Business and Work at 5 o'clock with the Small Business Programme, looking today at improving pay and conditions. And that takes us to the Open University at 6 o'clock, including the A to Z of English, followed at 6:25 by a scheme for making readers for life, and at 6:50, what you need for starting teaching. So first in the Learning Zone, FETV with the collectibles. This morning we continue the theme of numeracy skills with A Way with Numbers and Some Chance. The Some Chance series takes an entertaining look at how numbers affect our everyday lives, whilst A Way with Numbers explores the use of numbers in more depth and suggests ways of extending your skills. 16 out of the original series A Way with Numbers have been selected for this slot, and this morning we're showing the last four programmes, starting with the use of tables, from transport times to foreign currency.
Can this be crew? Oh, well, Bristol will have to do. That's the problem with travelling by TARDIS. It just seems to land any place, any old time. What the TARDIS really needs is some sort of timetable. And this programme is all about timetables and every kind of table. Well, almost every kind of table. Why we need tables and how to read tables. Now, whether you travel by trains and boats and planes or buses and Blackpool trams, timetables should make the going easier. If only they were easier to read. Now, we've set Sylvester McCoy, the intrepid time traveller, a timetable challenge to boldly go where he's never gone before. He has to make his way from Heathrow Airport to our studios in Bristol as fast as possible by public transport. And he's supposed to join me by the end of the programme. He set off quite some time ago. Hello, Sylvester. Where exactly are you?
Exactly. I'm at Heathrow Terminal 2, waiting for the coach to arrive.
And where's that going to go?
That's going to go to Reading. And according to the timetable, it comes every half hour. So there should be one here shortly.
And how long will that take you?
Well, it takes an hour to get from here to Reading. So I should be there about 9:45, I think. And according to the British Rail timetable, the train leaves at 10:10.
OK, well, I wish you luck.
Look, I must dash. The bus is here. I'll see you later. And so the intrepid traveller sets off. Oh!
That was earlier this morning, and I'm expecting Sylvester to phone again with his progress sometime later in the programme. Now, why do we need tables? Well, they're very handy ways of storing lots of information. But tables aren't just a jumble of facts and figures. For a table to be any use, it has to have some kind of order. Now, the simplest sort of table starts life as a list. And here's a list of groceries I buy regularly. I put the prices down the side, so it's just a shopping list, really. But if I write down last year's prices, and maybe earlier years too, the list turns into a simple table, which shows me how the prices have changed over the years. It's just the sort of table which appears in newspaper articles about inflation, when my simple table would look like this. Now, if I want to know how much tea cost in 1989, I follow the tea row across until I get to the column which gives the 1989 prices, and where the two meet gives me the figure I'm looking for, which is 52 pence. Now, all tables are based on some sort of rows and columns. And with this arrangement, I can keep a lot of information in quite a small space. For instance, the ABC Rail Guide isn't particularly big, and yet it contains details of every scheduled passenger train that runs in Great Britain. 800,000 journeys every week, everywhere from Chorlton cum Hardy to Chesterley Street. Mind you, the Radio Times has nothing on the Railway Times.
Oh, do hurry, Sir Horace, your train leaves in 28 minutes. If you don't catch the 10:15, you won't catch the 3:45, which leaves the 2... Oh!
I'm afraid Sir Horace won't be catching the 10:15, Lady Partridge. You can cancel his seat reservation.
Oh! And it was back to the engine, fourth coach along, so that he could see the gradient signs outside Swanborough.
Not anymore, Lady Partridge. The line's been closed.
Closed? Not Swanborough.
Now, I'm expecting Sylvester McCoy to arrive pretty soon. He left Heathrow Airport at 8:40 this morning, travelling by public transport, so I'll just check how he's getting on. Sylvester, where are you?
Well, as you can see, I'm not in Bristol yet, but we've just left Bath, so we'll be in Temple Meads very shortly.
Ah, lovely. How was the connection in Reading?
Fine. The bus arrived on time, 9:45, and then I immediately went to the timetable in the station and found out the platform number. Number 4, because in the small timetables, they don't give you the platform numbers.
No. So did the train leave Reading on time?
It was 1 or 2 minutes late, but we're more or less on time now.
OK. Yeah. So when you get to Bristol, how are you going to get to the studio?
Well, I'm going to catch a local bus, and according to this timetable, there's one leaving at 23 minutes past 11. So with a bit of luck, I should catch it.
All right, well, I hope to see you later.
Right. Bye.
Bye-bye. Now, Sylvester arrived in Reading at 09:45, so I can look at the intercity timetable to find out what train he's on and whether or not he's going to make it to the studio on time. Now, the train Sylvester caught in Reading Station actually started its journey in London Paddington, and that's table number 9, so we have 6, 7, 8, 9. Now, I have to make sure I'm looking at trains going in the right direction. They always travel from top to bottom, so we have London, Reading, Bristol, Temple Meads. Now, what day of the week is it? Well, we're recording this on a Tuesday, so I need Mondays to Fridays, and they seem to be marked in this yellow section of the timetable. Now, the time is given using the 24-hour clock, and it's printed as a block of 4 numbers. The first 2 are the hours, and the last 2 are the minutes. Now, Sylvester got to Reading at 09:45, so he just missed the 09:40, but he made the 10:10, the 10 minutes past 10 train. So I follow that train down, and we have Swindon, Bath Spa, Bristol, Temple Meads, and he should arrive in Bristol at 11:18, which gives him precious little time to get to the studio. Well, for planning journeys, the arrival times can be just as useful as departure times. Now, I want to travel from London to meet a friend in Edinburgh at about 4 p.m. next Friday. That's 1600 hours on the 24-hour clock. So first, I have to look at the arrival times and find out the one that best fits my arrangements. So this is the London to Scotland timetable. Now, there's a train here which arrives in Edinburgh at 15:34, which is very handy. So I trace back up the column to find out the time at which I have to catch the train in London, and that is 1100 or 11 o'clock in the morning. The timetable itself may not contain all the facts I need. If there's a little letter next to the time, and there's one here, that refers me to another list which is underneath. And here are all the exceptions to the rule, and I need to read them carefully, otherwise I can get really caught out.
I may have had the motive, Inspector, but I could not have done it. For I've only just arrived from Gillingham on the 8:13, and here is my restaurant car ticket to prove it.
But the 8:13 from Gillingham doesn't have a restaurant car.
It's a standing buffet only.
Simple. I caught the 7:16 football special, arriving at Swindon at 8:09.
But the 7:16 football special only stops at Swindon on alternate Saturdays.
Yes, surely you mean the Holidaymaker special.
Oh, yes.
How daft of me. Of course, I came on the Holidaymaker special, calling it Bedford, Combworth, Fendetton, Sutton, Wallington and Gillingham.
That's Sundays only.
Whatever my reasons for travelling, work or pleasure, birthday. I want to go dancing in Spain. Much of the information I'll need will be in the form of tables. Now, travel brochures contain many tables covering times, costs, sunshine, temperature, and so on. And here's a simple temperature chart which gives me a rough idea of how hot it is throughout the year. Now, all I have to do is pick the time. Let's say July, and in southern Spain it will be 87 degrees F. Degrees Fahrenheit, I notice. Now, the Spanish don't measure the temperature in degrees Fahrenheit. In fact, almost everywhere except the UK and the United States use the centigrade or Celsius scale, two names for the same thing. If I need to convert from one temperature scale to the other, the best way is to use a table or even a thermometer itself. Now, this one has both scales marked side by side. 60 degrees F is the same as 16 degrees C. Useful to remember. Now, if the temperature is 87 degrees Fahrenheit on the centigrade or Celsius scale, that's just over 30. 20 degrees centigrade is a pleasant room temperature, so 30 will be fairly warm. Just the thing to work up a mighty thirst.
You drinking?
You asking? At these prices, I'll be singing as well as dancing. It's all too easy to get carried away by unfamiliar currency. 190 pesetas for this, 500 pesetas for that. Soon you can lose track of how much you're spending. So, I'm making up a little table to convert pesetas into pounds and pence. Well, from this board, I can see that 100 pesetas is the same as 0.56 pounds, or 56 pence. So, 10 pesetas is 5.6 pence, roughly 5.5 pence. 20 pesetas is twice that, 11.2 pence, and so on. 90 pesetas, well, that's 9 multiplied by 5.6, and that is 50.4 pence, and 100 pesetas is 56 pence. So, the sangria at 190 pesetas is 56 plus 50.4, which is roughly 106 pence, or £1.06. It's quite a handy little thing to carry in your purse or pocket. A good way to solve a knotty little problem.
Just 500 years ago, in the mountains of South America, the Incas were considered the bee's knees. Their empire stretched over 2,000 miles, they built spectacular cities, and their pottery and goldwork were some of the finest the world had ever seen. There was just one snag. The Incas didn't use ink. In fact, writing was completely unknown, which presented a problem to the Inca government. They needed to keep records of how much tax a village should pay. Luckily, for the government, that is, someone had cottoned on to the idea of using knots. Lengths of string were tied onto a cord, with each string representing different items. One for maize, another for potatoes, and so on. Knots tied in the string were numbers indicating the amount of each item. With these tables of information, or quipus, it soon became practically impossible to avoid paying taxes. The number of llamas owned or crops grown could all be knotted down and used in evidence against you. So, although only special quipu readers were allowed to tie and interpret the knots, it was really the government who were pulling the strings.
If I'm planning to travel by road, the first thing I need to know, before I can plan anything else, is how long the journey will be. Well, here's a table of distances, a mileage chart, and at first sight it's pretty mind-boggling because it contains a huge amount of information. Now, suppose I have to deliver some stuff to a place in Fort William in the Highlands. Well, here is a list of places covered by this table. There's Bristol and there's Fort William further down. Now, the special feature about this table is that the rows and the columns have the same headings. There is the row for Bristol and there is the column for Bristol. Now, to find the distance from Bristol to Fort William, I put a ruler or a straight edge along the Fort William row and run my finger down the Bristol column. The place where they meet gives me the distance, 482 miles by road. That's quite a journey. Now, if I say that's roughly 500 miles and I drive at a good average speed of 50 miles an hour on mixed roads, then it's going to take me 500 divided by 50, that's 10 hours, and that doesn't include any stops, so I better get going. Now, some people's working lives are completely ruled by tables. Time and tide wait for no one.
Morecambe Bay is particularly dangerous because, looking at the records, in the past, no fewer than 130 people lost their lives crossing this bay. Those are the ones recorded, but there are others, many more besides, who haven't been recorded. My name is Cedric Robinson. I am a guide to the sands of the River Kent, and during the summer months I lead quite large numbers of people across the estuary for pleasure. Every morning of my life when I come downstairs, the first thing I do is check the time of the tide for that day if I'm going out onto the sands. Anyone as he's brought up to the sands really cannot follow the sands safely without referring to the tide table. In the days of old, there were no tide tables, and that's why there were so many people lost their lives out there, including the fishermen. The danger is when the tide comes in, on the highest of tides, it comes in at the speed of a galloping horse. No person could possibly outrun it. And the thing is, the tide never tires. Well, anyone who follows the sand for a living uses tide tables. From the Flukeborough fishermen, of course, they all refer to the tide tables. They fish not from a boat, from a formerly horse and cart, now tractors. They go out for many, many miles because we've got high sandbanks. And I say they have to know the time of the tide because there are meetings out there where the tide comes in both ways, and that can cut them off. Bob Dickinson's been fishing Morecambe Bay for, well, almost 50 years.
For catching white bait, you must have up to 18 foot of tide. Higher the tide, and better the white bait comes in. You look at your tide table before you go and pick your time, 3 hours ebb, say. That means that you're going 3 hours after high water. And that's your time you set off, you can fish them like. The best fish with the water on them is white bait. For the simple reason, you get them cleaner, you can give them a good wash in the water, and that's the best way to do it. You have an idea before you set off what time that tide will be turning. Once that tide comes in, there's no stopping it, like.
That is the question. But to get the answer I want from a table, sometimes I have to read between the lines. Now, if I borrow some money, I shall have to pay it back with interest. And this table tells me how much I should pay back every month for different amounts borrowed. If I borrow £1,500, the amount I repay isn't actually printed on this table, but I can work it out. It will be the amount for £500, and that's £47 a month, plus the amount for £1,000, which is £94 every month. Now, if I add those two together, I get £141 repayment every month. If I apply for this loan, or book a holiday, or buy from a catalogue, I'll probably have to fill in a form which is in the form of a table. Again, it's a matter of rows and columns, which imposes some kind of order on what I'm trying to order. This time, there are just headings: description, item price, quantity, and so on. And I have to fill in the rest. Now, you can see I've ordered some essential holiday items: pocket hammock, a portable bug killer, a clip-on fan, and so on. So this time I've made up a table for somebody else to read. Now, I'm in a bit of a hurry, so I hope this stuff arrives soon. And here is someone else in a hurry.
Yes, goodbye. Bye. See you again another day. Another time. It's always the same, isn't it? When you're late, people slow up, make you later still. I'm trying to catch a train. I'm going to see some friends in Bristol. I've got a timetable here. It's just... these are fiddling things, aren't they? Paddington, Bristol. Here we are. I should catch the 4 o'clock. Time was that if you wanted to catch a train, you would consult Bradshaw's Guide. Because in 1840, Bradshaw was the very first man to put all the times of all the trains in one book. No mean feat when you realise that in those days, nobody knew the real time. See, every town would set its time by a sundial, probably at noon in the middle of the town. So every town had a different time. It didn't matter. Except to people travelling between towns, perhaps on the railways, or people trying to sort out timetables. For them, it was chaos. Glasgow, 17 minutes behind London. Birmingham, 3 minutes behind London. So trains from Birmingham to London would leave Birmingham 3 minutes after the timetable time to be in line with the correct time and the timetable time by the time they arrived in London, provided they arrived on time. If you went from London to Bristol, it was a perfect example of what would happen. You would travel from Paddington going west and arrive after 40 miles in Reading. When you read the time in Reading, you'd find that your London time was now showing 4 minutes fast. On you would go through Wiltshire. Lots of potatoes in Wiltshire, because they have devices for Chippenham. And Chippenham was the next major stop, about 90 miles. And there you would find that your London time was showing 8 minutes fast. On to Bristol, about 130 miles. And the Bristol fashion was to have a variation of 14 minutes. So now your London time was showing 14 minutes fast. There's no gag in those days. People have a duff watch. People say, that's not the right time. You go, oh, no, no, this is London time. It was all sorted out around 1880, because by that time, they got telegraph wires running along all the main lines, and they could flash London time, or in actual fact, Greenwich Mean Time, around the country. But if you want to check those discrepancies today, you can still do it by looking in your papers at the lighting up times, because they follow the same variations. It's all due to the Earth moving under the sun at about 10 miles a minute. So London to Reading, 40 miles, 4 minutes variation. It works. But think about this. 10 miles a minute is 600 miles an hour. So the next time you're stuck in traffic or in a train that's not moving, don't grumble, because you're still travelling at 600 miles an hour. I mean, how fast do you want to travel? I'm going to miss my train. See ya. Bye-bye.
Only a few more minutes to the end of the programme and Sylvester still hasn't arrived. Well, I can get a good idea of where he is if I look at a bus timetable. If you're a stranger in town, then one of the most difficult things is to find out which number bus you actually need. Well, the easiest way is to ask someone, one of the locals. But you can also find out either by looking at a route map or by scanning the destinations on timetables. Now, Sylvester will be travelling from Bristol Temple Meads Station to the studios here at White Ladies Road. And by looking at a summary of bus routes, I can see that numbers 1, 2 and 3 all call at Temple Meads and White Ladies Road. Now, if I look at the timetable for bus numbers 1, 2 and 3, Mondays to Fridays, Temple Meads going in the right direction, the bus